This program is brought to you by Emory University.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the graduation ceremony for the BBA class of 2012. And let me be the first to congratulate. This class continues in a long list of incredible students at this school. I mean, we could not be more proud of this BBA class. It's a wonderful group of students. We're thrilled to see them, we're thrilled to see them finish, but that's not entirely true. We hate to see them go in many ways. They're just a great group, and I just want to tell you personally, I'm the dean, and I have many programs that we run in the school. I'm going to get this count wrong, but I think it's six. But I'm going to tell you something. The BBA program is my absolute favorite. It is my favorite. When we talk about community around this school, and, community is not just the big picture community, it's the everyday. And you BBAs bring an energy and a life to our school that you don't see at other schools that don't have a BBA program, and especially a BBA program as special as ours. Now, sometimes it feels like you're kind of climbing the walls, but that's okay. You're full of energy. Keep it up. We couldn't be more proud of you. And personally, I have a blast because the students, the BBA students, are not shy about asking me for things. And I enjoy it. So this year, I can just name a bunch of things. So we had a group that runs our investor club that comes to me and says to me, we want $100,000 to invest. Well, guess what? They have $100,000 to invest. We have our annual, the annual leadership conference, and they come to me and they say, we want money and we want speakers. Well, this year's conference, and I had nothing to do with this one, by the way, was one of the best ever. Of course, we had some amazing people, and I can't remember his name. Thank you. I got to tell a story about Usher. One day, I was supposed to have lunch with Usher, and I went home. I told my wife, I'm having lunch with Usher. I said, who's Usher? And that was not a good thing. But anyway, I mean, there's so many other examples. I see them around our centers working. I'm particularly interested in alternative investments, and I just love the kids that are working around there. They make this thing go. So we are going to miss all of you, and I know you're going to miss us too. I want you to do me a favor, though. I want you to say a big thank you to your families. I mean, come on. They made this happen. So to the families. Now, I can't get away without making some formal remarks. So I wrote my speech, and it's all right here. It's four words. I said, that's the best way. What do you really want to tell them? I said, there's four words I want to share with you, and just a little note on each one. And the first word is international. I just want to make you aware, if you're not already aware and you're leaving here, that you're moving not into a big picture as part of this country. You're moving into the world. That we and you now are competing with your peers all over the world. We're doing great, but they're catching up, and it's up to you to make sure that we continue to lead the world, and you guys have to lead that way. So don't forget about international. You need to learn about your competitors. You need to learn as much as you can about the people you're working with. Don't stay narrow. Don't think just in your local neighborhood. The second word was knowledge. So you think you're educated, right? Let me give you a little a piece of information. You have a lot of knowledge, but you're not educated. You got a long way to go, and in fact, you will never be educated. You've got to continue to learn. What you know now is going to be, I wouldn't say obsolete, but certainly there's going to be advances in the next 5 or 10 years that you want to make sure you know about, advances in management and other practices. So don't forget that. You cannot stop learning. The third word on my list is integrity. And that's very important to us. We carry the name of Roberto Goizueta on our school, and we carry it very proudly. He was a fabulous business leader. I mean, we have a mural that's going in the building. It's going to be unveiled on Monday that tracks his career. When he started at the Coca-Cola Company, I believe the market value of Coca-Cola, equity value, was $4 billion. And when he left, and under unfortunate conditions, it was over $180 billion. That's the kind of value added. And he made some interesting choices along the way, like New Coke. That's all up there. But in the meantime, but what was more important was he did it right. Integrity was so important to him. And when he endowed this school and early on projected his vision for this school, it was all about doing things right. So don't forget that. And I can tell you from personal experience, you're very young and you don't know this, but take it from me who's had a lot more experience. You will be tested. There will be situations, you can be sure of it, multiple times, where you're going to have to make some choices, and some of them are going to be hard because some things are going to look really good, but then when you look at them, you say, well, maybe there's something not quite right with that. Be careful. Do the right thing. And then the last one is passion. And I know everybody says this, and it's cliche, but I'm going to say it again. Don't do what everybody expects you to do. Do what you want to do. If you do what you want to do, you will be the leaders we expect of you. And when you become leaders, do it boldly. Don't hold back. That's what it takes to be a great leader. So those are my four words. We're watching you. We'll keep track of you. We always follow many of our alums. And on that note, I just want to say congratulations and give them a big hand.
Hello, I'm Andrea Hershetter. I am the director of the BBA program, and I do know who Usher is. Congratulations, class of 2012. It's a thrill to see you all here and to have this opportunity to warmly welcome our guests, starting with your parents. We're truly grateful for the trust you've placed in us and for the gift you've given us by sharing your sons and your daughters with us. We share your pride in what they've accomplished and your confidence in their futures. Their successes are their own, but it is you who have laid the foundations that made these achievements possible. As you'll see today, they're an extraordinary group, all well above average. Unfortunately, this presents a small problem for our faculty as they try to implement our ever-popular grading distribution. To all the brothers, sisters, cousins, aunts, uncles, grandparents, extended family, and almost family members, some of whom have come from continents away, thank you for being here and for adding so much significance to the weekend. We feel we know many of you. We've heard countless stories about the businesses you run, the places you travel, the people you know, and the schools you attended. You're loved and admired, and you set the standard to which our graduates aspire. I'm also particularly glad to see a few alumni returning to cheer on the graduates. Yeah, you were the best class when you were here, and no, you probably would not be admitted if you were applying now. And to any lingering members of the class of 2011, just remember, 5 is the new 3. Actually, the truth is that we all stand on your shoulders. It's our alumni who paved the way for each successive generation, and we can only hope that the class of 2012 will do as much for future BBA students as our alumni have done for them. The collective show of support here is amazing. More than 1,000 people are in the audience today, and on Monday, after joining all the other Emory degree programs for commencement, we'll gather one last time as a program for the diploma ceremony and a champagne reception. However, that day is about graduating and looking forward. Today is about relishing where we've been. We'll recognize the class's collective and individual accomplishments and journey together through words, pictures, and performances to celebrate this amazing class of 2012. A significant part of the effort behind our program today came from members of the BBA Council. This graduation celebration is just another example of the countless ways in which your elected leaders support, nurture, and enhance the program. I'd like to ask you to recognize the graduating members of the 2012 BBA Council for their dedication and hard work. Ali, Karen, Aaron, Vince, Adam, Willie, Adam, Amy, and Kelly, would you please stand? Thank you so much. If you all will see us after this ceremony, we have a small token of our appreciation for you. I'm going to ask a few more groups to stand up. First, I'd like to offer some much-deserved recognition to our varsity athletes. Your work ethic, dedication, and determination are an inspiration to us all. I'm very proud to note that we have a full dozen varsity team captains in the graduating class. I'd like to especially recognize Corey Spraggins, winner of the McDonough Award for positive contributions to the Emory community as a student, athlete, and citizen, Natalie Schoenfeld, winner of the Ralph and Russell Bridges Award presented to the outstanding all-around female varsity athlete, as well as Daniel Kolb and Paul Weinstein, winners of prestigious NCAA postgraduate scholarships. While your program lists only the current varsity athletes, I'd like to now ask that all members of the graduating class who played varsity sports at Emory stand and be recognized. Additionally, as noted in your program, we were delighted that so many of our graduating BBA students were selected to be among the 100 most outstanding members of the Emory senior class. In a minute, I'll ask you to rise so we can identify you. You may note that the BBA program represents about 20% of the Emory class of 2012, but if you're counting, you'll see that 31% of the seniors on the list are part of the senior honorary. I'm just saying. I'd like to ask the 100 senior honorary, along with the members of Mortarboard, ODK, and Order of Omega, as well as those top for Emory's secret societies and the recipients of Emory of any Emory College awards, to please rise at this time. I have one more shout out for you. This one is to Jonathan Lafer, whose audition remarks for class orator were so much fun that we asked him for permission to share the Goizueta a la mode recipe with you as an insert in your graduation program. Jonathan, are you here? Obviously, there's so many other ways that our students contribute that we can't possibly recognize each of them. It's your cumulative efforts that make us who we are as a university and as a program. At this time, I think you deserve our formal gratitude. Class of 2012, if you were involved in Emory through music or performing arts, became a global citizen by participating in study abroad, took an active or leadership role in a club, community service, or competition, helped by contributing to the class gift, or just feel like you did something sometime during the last 4 years that deserves some recognition, would you please stand at this time? Usually, this is the moment when I offer our graduates a few thoughts about our mission, values, and key takeaways from the Goizueta Business School. However, this year, for reasons that will become immediately apparent, instead of reiterating what I hope you learned from the program, I would like to share a slightly different message with you. With the belief that the future is illuminated by those who have forged the way in the past, each year the graduating class chooses a quote that most inspires them to leadership. The class of 2012 quote is from an interview with Steve Jobs, who said, "My favorite things in life don't cost any money. It's really clear that the most precious resource we have is time." We dedicate this quote to the memory of two beloved members of this class, Joshua Spencer Bush and Evan Douglas Lounsbury. If Evan and Josh were here today, they would probably be feeling a lot like you. Happy, relieved, maybe already a little nostalgic, perhaps scared, full of anticipation, and definitely proud of their accomplishments. Like you, they probably would not be consciously thinking of time as a precious or particularly limited resource. Nevertheless, Evan and Josh, each in their own way, were all about living in the moment. And that's really what I want to tell you. Live in the moment. You're all so smart, so talented, so capable of leaving your mark on the world. I know you will accomplish amazing things. But don't rush it quite so much. Take your time and relish the path, even if it's an indirect one. It's not a race, and it's not about the destination. Along your way, embrace the challenges. The more difficult moments are those that best help us to grow, learn, and move forward with renewed vigor and insight. For those who don't have the perfect job yet, don't panic. This includes your parents. You have all the skills and credentials you need, and of course, we will continue to work with you. You'll find something wonderful soon. But until then, enjoy these moments of continuing exploration. If you do have a job, think of it as formative, as a next step along a winding road that will take many unexpected turns, and not as a means to an end. Churn and burn is illegal as a financial strategy, and it's no way to live your life. Don't mark your calendar now for 3 years out to an MBA program. When you saw our own MBAs hanging out in the commons, did they look like they were having any fun to you? Seriously. And don't measure your worth by the speed at which your salary or title expands. Don't wish one moment away, waiting to get to some future time in order to reach some arbitrary mark. Do treat time as a resource. Invest it, put it to work for you, and make sure it yields you returns measured not in dollars, but in joy. Live in the moment, in every moment. Make the most of where you are, wherever that is. Engage in the work, connect with the people you encounter, strive to exceed expectations, and invoke your knowledge and ability all the time. Find a way to make a difference and to use your considerable talents to enrich not only yourselves, but your organizations and society as a whole. Do it not just in memory of those who are with us here today only in spirit, but in honor of those who are sitting with you right now and have invested so much in this moment and in your future happiness. And do it for yourselves. Embrace the journey for its own sake, and you will find that the path you're on always has the potential to be the right one. I'll close with this wish for you. May all of your favorite things always be free. May you have them in abundance. And may the precious resource of time be yours for many, many, many moments. Thank you. Now, as Secretary of the Emory Chapter of Beta Gamma Sigma, the highest national scholastic honorary society in business, it's my pleasure to officially induct some members of the graduating class into the society. Beta Gamma Sigma's mission is to encourage and honor academic achievement in the study of business and to foster personal and professional excellence among its members. It is the only scholastic honorary recognized by AACSB, the International Business Accreditation Society. Selection is based on academic achievement and limited by quality of character. I'd like to ask our new members of Beta Gamma Sigma to come to the stage at this time so that we may recognize you and present you with the Beta Gamma Sigma cord to wear proudly on your graduation robes on Monday, signifying your academic accomplishment. If you'll come forward while I explain what Beta Gamma Sigma stands for, I'd appreciate it. Beta is the initial letter of the word bibios, which signifies honor as defined by personal integrity and excellence of character. Gamma is the initial letter of the Greek word gnosis, meaning wisdom, tested by experience and tempered by discerning judgment. Sigma is the initial of the Greek word spude, which means earnestness or enthusiasm, measured by achievement, disciplined by reason, and ennobled by sincerity. These are the attributes with which a Beta Gamma Sigma inductee is charged, and we will do so in one moment. I think you're going to have to squeeze a little. Too many of you and you're too smart. We may have to do two lines. I know this is going to be hard, parents, but if you could hold your applause till the end. When I call your name, will you please step forward? Dorothy Kate Abrams, Elizabeth Lauren Backash, Stephen Michael Bomsey, Joshua Robert Buer, Gregory Robert Boris, Aaron Samuel Brooks, Anne Marie Cheslin, Gabriella Christina Choi, Dylan Michael Connor, Allison Toba Daniels, Alexander Epstein, Hawk Hay Fung, Lindsay Sarah Goldman, Seth Michael Green, Adam Christopher Grenier, William Dan Guo, Adam Jeffrey Hamburg, Callie Alyssa Jordan, Tristan Corey Kochik, Blake Num Kavanaugh, Daniel Milton Kolb, Andrew Albert Krolitis, Janice Mingru Kuo, Brandon Michael Locke, Imran Amin Manji, Michelle Suzanne Mullaney, Sari Faye Newman, Alexa Michelle Payton, John Michael Peterson, Charles Gregory Punia, Samuel D. Rothschild, Benjamin David Schlang, Michael Ian Seidman, Sebastian Sinisterra, Richard Frank Walker, Shi Angie Wang, and David Thomas Wickman. Congratulations, members of Beta Gamma Sigma. I would now like to call upon Blake Kavanaugh, who will deliver the Beta Gamma Sigma remarks.
Here, on the precipice of graduating, I'd like to take a moment to reflect on not only the reasons we came here to Goizueta, but why the school exists. Let me better frame that question with a thought from a fellow Atlantan, Martin Luther King Jr. He said, "Education which stops with efficiency may prove to be the greatest menace to society. We must remember that intelligence is not enough. Intelligence plus character. That is a goal of true education. The complete education gives one not only the power of concentration, but worthy objectives upon which to concentrate." So what sort of objectives should we be concentrating on? There's a story I think might have the answer to this. It's found in the Bible, the Talmud, and the Quran, and it's the story of David and Goliath. In case you haven't heard the story before, basically it goes something like this. There's this kid, David. He watches sheep, and he plays a harp, and he's real good with a slingshot. And his dad asks him to go and visit his brothers, who bring him some food, and they're in the army. And he goes down there, and he notices this giant. It's from the enemy's campsite, and he's taunting this army. And so he says, you know, what's going on right here? And they say that basically what's going on is that everyone's intimidated by him. He's a giant. And so no one would dare fight him. And so obviously he goes and fights him. He goes to the giant, this little boy, and he challenges the giant. And he grabs his slingshot and he puts a rock in it. And he flings it around and around. And he throws it and it soars through the air. And it hits the giant right in the forehead. And the giant falls to the ground. And David runs and grabs Goliath's sword right to the neck. And just like that, the little boy beat the giant, Goliath. Many of us know this story, yet tradition tells us something that we often leave out. You see, this wasn't the only giant. David was just the first one. After him, there were at least four more people who went around killing giants. But David became king. He became the legend. And no one really knows or cares about these other four guys. And why is that? Well, by the time everyone else got around to killing giants, it kind of became commonplace. And what kind of courage does it really take to kill a giant if everyone else is doing it? And that's the point, you see. The courage to lead requires not waiting for others to allow you to make the right decision. It's about making the right decision so it becomes easier for everyone else to follow suit. This is the kind of leadership that our business leaders should have had 4 years ago before the global financial crisis. And this is the kind of leadership that we need to have. Roberto Goizueta, our school's namesake, put it beautifully. He said, "We must never forget that our leadership carries a heavy burden. Those who were always first live in the white light of scrutiny and become targets for the envious and the jealous. We must live our lives with intelligence and intellectual courage and loyalty and integrity, knowing that for us, the stakes are always higher." So, fellow classmates, class of 2012, we've been prepared. We know what it is to courageously lead. And if we each make just a ripple, combined, they would make a tidal wave of change. And that change is what this world so desperately needs. Thank you.
I'd like to present an award to Blake on behalf of the BGS remarks that he just made.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the graduation celebration for the BBA class of 2012. My name is Willie Guo, and this is my classmate, Karen Boomer. Tonight, we will be your masters of ceremony, and we're truly honored.
Our first performance is from Oral Pleasure, which is an award-winning a cappella group here on campus. They will be performing Let It Be, featuring BBA graduate Nikki Taylor as a soloist, and then Rolling in the Deep, featuring BBA graduate Jess Levis as soloist. Enjoy.
I find myself in times of trouble. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be.
And when the broken-hearted people living in this world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though we may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer. Let it be. Yeah. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be. There will be an answer.
And it's bringing me out the dark. Finally, I can see you.
crystal clear. Go ahead and sell me out and I'll lay your ship bare. See how I leave with every piece of you. Don't underestimate the things that I will do. There's a fire starting in my heart, reaching my fever pitch and it's bringing me out the dark. The scars of your love remind me of us. They keep me thinking that we almost had it all. The scars of your love, they leave me breathless. I can't. We could have had it high. Rolling in the deep. You had my heart inside your head. But you played it with a story to be told, but I've heard one on you and I'm gonna make your head burn. Think of me in the depths of your despair and make a home down there as mantra won't be shared. The scars of your love remind me of us. They keep me thinking that we almost had it all. The scars of your love, they leave me breathless. I can't.
It's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker today, Professor Bill Taylor. Professor Taylor has taught at Emory since 2007 when he received a PhD in management from Cornell. Previously, he received both a BS in accounting and an MA in professional accounting from BYU, as well as an MS in management from Cornell. Professor Taylor clearly likes school. So it's no surprise he's one of the most highly regarded professors in the business school. He currently teaches managerial accounting, one of our core classes. The thing about core classes is the generally large class size, but Professor Taylor makes a conscious effort to understand his students on a personal level. He describes his teaching style as a personal approach and makes an effort to know his students on a first-name basis, which is difficult. In addition to teaching, Professor Taylor has been published in a number of the top finance and accounting journals, and he has presented research at over 30 universities. He's won a number of teaching awards, including Emory's prestigious Crystal Apple Award for Emerging Excellence. Unfortunately for us at Emory, Professor Taylor will be leaving at the end of the summer to go back to BYU to teach, but he has agreed to provide us with this one last lecture. We wish him all the best. Please welcome Professor Bill Taylor.
Thank you, Manvir, for that kind introduction. What a privilege it is to be able to speak to such a prestigious group. You have come so far and accomplished so much, and it's truly an honor to be able to share in some small way in your accomplishments today and to share a few parting words as you complete your journey here at Emory. Now, I know a lot of you. I don't know all of you, but I'm a little bit worried that even those who I know from the classroom but haven't seen in a while might not recognize me. I can just say that I'm another victim of the global recession of the last few years. Now, I think I speak for all of your professors when I say, please keep in touch. That way, in 15 years or so, we can see how age has taken its toll on you, and we can make fun of you a little bit. And if you recall, I think I have access to all of your pictures. And so 15 years from now, I can make a slide like this for you someday. Willie, beware. Now, in 15 years, a lot can change. Who knows where you'll be 15 years from now? You might find yourself standing in front of a classroom teaching students and who don't seem to get your jokes because the TV shows you're quoting aren't in reruns anymore. You might also find that your hip-sounding generation has been replaced by an even hipper-sounding generation. And you might find that the word hip isn't used the way it used to be. But wherever you find yourself 15 years from now, it's my hope that you'll be able to look back on your time since leaving Emory and see that you've made a difference in the world, see that you've made the world a better place. It's my opinion that you come into Emory to learn, but that you go forth to serve. And that's what I'd like to talk to you a little bit about today. I think the thing that astounds me the most, I know the thing that astounds me the most every semester, is how much my students serve others, even with the constant stresses that they face in school. I remember learning early on that Sandra Barlon served in the Filipino Student Association, helping to eradicate poverty in the Philippines. I remember learning how Tess Wilkins served in the Residence Hall Association, helping to organize any number of events for her fellow students. I remember discovering how Laura Lambie Hansen served with the Humane Society and Habitat for Humanity, and how Vignesh Narayanaswamy served with the Human Rights Action Group. And the list goes on and on. And of course, much of the service that you've given is not to official organizations. They're not the types of things that can be listed on a resume. Much of the service that you've given are things like service you give to a fellow student who's struggling to prepare for an exam, or a coworker who's struggling with a new task at work, or the service that you give when you post a nice comment on a friend's Facebook page to lift their spirits, or the service you give to a random stranger in a mall when you give them a nice smile. It's hard for a management accountant like myself to admit this publicly, but I've heard it said, and I agree, that much of what counts cannot be counted. Much of what counts cannot be counted. In fact, some of the best service that you will give will go completely unnoticed by the world. And many of you, if not all of you, might find yourself, maybe you're already there, losing track of the time you give serving because it's just become a way of life. Now, tomorrow is a very important day for us. Tomorrow we celebrate our mothers, who so often give so much for our success and our happiness that their sacrifices can be diluted by their sheer quantity. Now, if you'll indulge me just for a few moments, I'd like to share with you some thoughts about a few of the great women who have served as my mother at various points in my life. And I'd like to share with you the lessons of service that I've learned from them. So My first mom, my biological mother, died many years ago. She and my father died by the time I was 11 years old. But their sacrifices for their children did not go unnoticed. Both of my parents worked long hours so that my siblings and I could have an easier and better life than they had. My mom was probably much like many of yours. She loved me, but did not always love all of the choices that I made. She was often tired from a long, hard day's work, but she always seemed to have just enough oomph in her at the end of the day to let me know that she was there for me, to tuck me in at night, and to lift me up when I was down. Now, when I think about my mother, I recall the words of Winston Churchill, who said that we make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give. So my first admonition for you as you go out into the world is to be something more than your career. You should find a way to give back so that you can make a life as you make your living. Now, after my parents passed away, I inherited four more mothers. The first was my grandmother. She had moved to Florida to be closer to her daughter, my mother, and to enjoy her retirement in the warm Florida weather. When my parents passed away, she agreed to share in the guardianship of my brother and myself. Now, in doing so, she had to make dramatic changes to her everyday life. In the blistering summer heat, she would wear sweaters because my brother and I at any moment would go and drop the AC down as low as it would go. She learned to live on a diet of tacos and pizza because that seemed to be the only thing these two teenage boys would eat. And she risked life and limb teaching two young boys how to drive and put up with our constant complaints that she was risking our life with her driving. Now, in short, she gave up the long-awaited retirement that she had looked forward to for decades, and in fact that she had earned and continued to give. Now, years later, at the age of 96, my grandmother fell very ill. And I drove to see her, drove many hours to see her at the hospital. And when I arrived at the hospital, I saw her being rolled on a bed through the hallway towards the lab for testing, and I was shocked. I could hardly recognize her. She had lost so much weight and was in a very frail state. She hadn't eaten for days, and it showed. But I'll never forget the words that she spoke to me when she saw me. She looked at me and she said, "How wonderful to see you. Have you had any breakfast? Are you hungry?" So here's my 96-year-old grandmother who hasn't eaten for days, and she's worried about whether or not I've had anything to eat that day. So in the business school, we talk a lot about competition and about self-interest. But the next admonition I would give to you, and this is a lesson I learned from my grandmother, is to forget yourselves and remember to serve. My next mother was actually just a woman from church who was close friends with my grandmother. When my grandma got the call that my parents had passed away, she turned first to this friend, not knowing what else to do. My grandmother had actually lost her own husband just a week earlier. And Jeannie Christensen, this friend, didn't wait to be didn't ask, "What can I do to help?" I'll remember always seeing her and her family show up on my front yard to do yard work, just out of the blue. That was my chore. Now, this might seem like a small gesture against the backdrop of such a huge tragedy, but to me it sent the message far more powerfully than words could convey that someone cared. Now, Jeannie's service to our family continued in many ways for many years. In fact, one of the things she did for us was provide Sunday dinners to my family, and that continued on until I was married and had children of my own. Now, whether small or great, sometimes, often, the best acts of service that you'll give will never be solicited. As Emily Dickinson once said, "They might not need me, but they might. I'll let my head be just in sight. A smile, as small as mine might be, precisely their necessity." From Jeannie, the message of service that I would give to you is, don't wait to be asked to serve, just do it. My fourth mother was Renee Matthews. Renee was actually my best friend's mom and was also the best friend of my mom before my mother passed away. Now, Renee, in our time of crisis, was uniquely qualified to help rescue our family. Renee was a businesswoman, and perhaps more importantly, she was listed in my parents' will as the person they would have care for my brother and me should something happen to them. Now, the courts were reluctant to let my grandmother be our sole guardian because of my grandmother's age, and they were worried about her ability to navigate the complexity of my parents' trust, but they agreed to allow my grandmother to care for us if Renee was willing to help with the financial and legal matters. And now, Renee's service went far beyond that, and Renee had many problems of her own that she was facing, including a recent divorce and an ongoing battle with breast cancer. But, again, she was uniquely qualified to serve, and she did what needed to be done. You are about to receive a degree from one of the best educational institutions in the world. You have learned so much in the past few years and have acquired new talents and skills and abilities. Thus, my next admonition to you is this: don't wait for someone else who is better suited to serve. You are uniquely qualified for the service that lies ahead. And the last woman that helped serve as my mother was my older sister, Allison. Allie had just graduated from college and, of course, had just lost her parents as well. She had big plans, and helping to care for her two younger brothers was not part of the itinerary. However, as I pointed out before, the courts were concerned about my grandmother's age as the sole guardian, but they agreed to keep my brother and me out of foster homes, and they probably would have had to be separate foster homes, if my sister would agree to be a co-guardian with my grandmother. So my sister put her life on hold and became a mother of two teenage boys at the age of 22. Many of you are 22 years old. You have big plans, and you might not have younger siblings that need you to take care of them, but there are so many people out there that are desperately in need of your help. My next admonition to you is this: don't wait until it's convenient to serve. There is no end to the heights that you can climb in your personal ambitions. As you climb, reach out to help those around you to come up with you. If you serve when you are low on the ladder, you will continue to serve when you are at the top. And there's one last mom that I need to mention, especially as it pertains to service, and that's my dear wife, Sarah. I have watched her give everything and serve tirelessly over the last dozen years for the welfare of our children. She has built a legacy through her service. All of us are building legacies of one kind or another. No one is going to speak at our funeral about our net worth. They're going to focus on the ways that we've improved the lives of other people. So my final admonition to you is to let your legacy be about the service that you have rendered. Your education here at Emory now comes to an end, but your service out there is just beginning. So do well, and more importantly, do good. Thank you.
This is a small token of our appreciation for Professor Taylor. He's leaving us this year, but we really appreciate your time here, Professor Taylor. Thank you so much.
Our next performance this afternoon will be Katarina Lee, a BBA graduate, who will be playing Liebe Strome, number 3, by Franz Liszt on the piano. Enjoy.
Thank you.
It's now my honor to present the BBA Academic Awards. In the interest of time, as I read these awards, I'd like to ask you to stand if you're the recipient and be recognized, and then make your way to the stage to receive your award so we can move on to the next award and not wait during the transitions. The first set of awards are the Accounting Awards. The Campbell Accounting Award is presented to the student, or in this case students, who have attained the highest scholastic average in accounting during his or her, or in this case their, senior year. The Campbell Award this year goes to Andrew Albert Krolitis and Shi Angie Wang. John R. Jones Accounting Award is presented to an undergraduate accounting student in recognition of outstanding academic and personal characteristics. The award this year goes to Adam Jared Ginsburg. The Atlanta Society of Financial Analysts Award is presented by the finance faculty to an undergraduate student who demonstrates outstanding academic scholarship and whose contribution to the classroom creates a better learning environment for both students and faculty. The award this year goes to Gregory Robert Boris and Tristan Corey Kochik. I'm sorry, I skipped over one accounting award. The Educational Foundation of the Georgia Society of CPAs Award is presented to the graduating senior with a concentration in accounting who has attained the highest scholastic average over the four-year course of, in this case, her undergraduate program. The award this year goes to Michelle Suzanne Mullaney. Partnership Award in Finance is presented by the Finance Faculty to the most outstanding undergraduate student in Finance, and this year goes to Benjamin David Schlang. The Real Estate Award is presented by the Finance Faculty to the most outstanding undergraduate student in real estate, and this year is shared by two students, Sachin Nagpal and Stephen Charles Skinyetsny. Information Systems and Operations Management Distinction Award is presented by the ISUM faculty to the graduating senior who best exemplifies excellence in the field of information systems and operations analysis, and the award this year goes to Imran Amin Manji. The American Marketing Association Award is presented by the marketing faculty to the most outstanding undergraduate student in marketing. This award is given based on academic performance and the student's contribution to the marketing area. The award this year goes to Adar Miriam Morag. The Marketing Faculty Honor Award is presented by the faculty to the most outstanding student, or in this case, students in marketing, based on academic performance and an overall service to the area. The award goes to Dorothy Kate Abrams and Callie Alyssa Jordan. Emory Mack Award for Academic Achievement is presented to a graduating student for academic achievement in marketing analytics coursework and contributions to the Emory Marketing Analytics Center. The award this year goes to Blake Nam Kavanaugh. The Organization and Management Faculty Award is presented to the graduating student making the most significant contribution to the field of organization and management, and also goes to Imran Amin Manji. A new award this year, the Social Enterprise Distinguished BBA Student Award, is presented to the graduating student who has distinguished herself in the field of social enterprise. The award this year goes to Karen Elaine Boomer. If we could take 1 minute and congratulate all the academic award winners. BBA program awards recognize students for their contributions to the program, school, or university as a whole. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the students who earlier this year were included in Who's Who among students in American universities and colleges. These students were selected based on the Who's Who criteria of young adults who enhance the positive image of American youth through their contributions to community and school. Their names are in your program, but please stand and be acknowledged for this honor, and please see us at the end of the program to receive a small memento acknowledging your inclusion. The BBA Scholar Athlete Award goes to the graduating business student who has most effectively balanced the demands of varsity athletics with the rigors of the academic program. The award this year goes to a 4-year member of the Emory varsity soccer team who has maintained his team status and commitment despite injury and who is graduating with highest distinction in the top 5% of the BBA class, Benjamin David Schlang. Campus Leadership Award is given to the graduating senior who has served as an exemplary BBA representative through leadership beyond the Goizueta Business School and whose efforts have made an extraordinary contribution to the larger university. This year's winners display significant depth and breadth of involvement. He has done so through SPC, his leadership in moderating the newly reinvigorated Wonderful Wednesdays, and his capable presidency of the Interfraternity Council. She has led through her roles on the Senior Experience Committee, as chairman of the Food Advisory Committee, and in her outspoken, somewhat contentious, and vitally important position as Campus Services Chair of the Student Government Association. I'm very pleased to present the Campus Leadership Award to Seth Michael Green and Haley Michelle Ratner. Budnick Award for Transformation Through Creativity is awarded to the graduating student who has most successfully applied artistic and creative talents to enhance and expand the horizons of the business school or university. This award is named to honor BBA alum Scott Budnick, whose exemplary success in the film industry and dedicated commitment to Emory inspired its creation. The award this year goes to 3 students, each of whom is already achieving recognition for his or her creative output. A myriad of professional clients and countless Emory filmmakers have made great use of Adrian's talents as a graphic artist, while we in the BBA program have been shameless beneficiaries of her ready willingness to design print media, logos, and t-shirts for us. Seth and Matt serve as president and vice president of ETV, have each produced a Campus Movie Fest award-winning film, and are both in post-production on their own independent short films. All 3 bring prestige to the BBA program and enrich our lives artistically and otherwise by expanding our worldview through their creative endeavors. I proudly present the Budnick Award for Transformation Through Creativity to Seth Harris Becker, Adrian Mariel Ford, and Matthew David Gaines. The International Ambassador Award is presented by an interdepartmental committee to the student who has done the most to assist the school in its efforts to forge cross-cultural ties and extend its global reach. Our 2012 International Ambassador is fluent in three languages, gives voice to cultural expression as an award-winning performing artist, volunteers on behalf of underprivileged artisans in India, ventured to the Arctic North to study abroad as our first exchange student at the Stockholm School of Economics, and has been instrumental in the phenomenal success of the Emerging India Summit, serving last year as the Corporate Relations Chair and this year as its President. She is a citizen of the world who spreads goodwill wherever she goes and is most deserving of the International Ambassador Award, Shreya Savitri Adaraju. The Meritorious Service Award this year goes to three very deserving seniors. Each will graduate from the business school with honors, and their contributions begin in the classroom, but they do not end there. Our recipients are vibrant members of your BBA Council, who among them have brought you extraordinary council programming, including the first ever BBA Atlanta Alumni Networking event, the Shadows Program, weekly kegs, leadership speakers and conference events, and many free t-shirts. For their collective work in significantly enhancing the scope, depth, and enjoyment of your undergraduate experience through service beyond expectation and well beyond wings and beer, and for their support of the mission of the BBA program, the Meritorious Service Award goes to Aaron Samuel Brooks, Vincent David Celentano II, and Adam Christopher Grenier. Core Value Award is presented to the graduating senior or seniors who most notably embody principled leadership by demonstrating personal and professional growth, intellectual development, and an imperative to create positive change in organizations. Two members of the class share the award this year. Both are members of 100 Senior Honorary, and both are recipients of Emory's prestigious Humanitarian Award. He has served as a member of the BBA Honor Council, founder of the Emory Interreligious Leadership Council, Vice President of Omicron Delta Kappa Honorary Society, and President of the Emory Student Muslim Association, for which he received the College Council President of the Year Award. She has helped with adult education efforts for the International Rescue Committee, taught children in Ethiopia, served as an intern in the Atlanta Mayor's Office of Weed and Seed, and co-founded the Advanced ESL GED Refugee Tutoring Program, efforts that led to her selection as a participant in the esteemed Clinton Global Initiative Summit. Together, they exhibit a strength of character, concern for community, and dedication to humanity that makes us honored to have them represent everything for which the BBA program stands. The 2012 Core Values Award goes to Assad Razi Abdullah and Bethel Amare Tazira. The BBA Unsung Heroine Award is presented to the graduating student who has rendered notable service to the program, the university, or the larger community without expectation of reward or recognition. This award pays tribute to our recipients' under the radar yet highly effective leadership across many parts of the university. As a junior, she served as co-president of Hillel at Emory, managing a budget of more than $1 million and meeting the needs of 2,000 community members. She was also one of the founding members and first president of Waller Scholars, a mentoring organization that works with low-wealth school systems in Atlanta, and was selected as a 2010-11 member of Emory's 100 Community Builders. A superior student, she will graduate as a member of Beta Gamma Sigma with high distinction. This year, she served in the difficult, thankless, but crucial role of Chief of Staff to the University Student Government Association. For her work behind the scenes that makes us a stronger and more compassionate community, the Unsung Heroine Award goes to Dorothy Kate Abrams. Bert and Betty Shear Book Prize, honoring the four Shear children who graduated from Emory, includes a beautiful 10th anniversary book edition entitled Earth from Above that contains photographs taken in 75 countries from the open door of a helicopter. It is awarded to the student most likely to make a uniquely positive mark on his or her universe. At the Shear's request, this is an award that is not necessarily based on specific achievements, but rather on a potential boundless future. Our recipient has chosen finance as the way in which he will influence his part of the world. Already serving as the very active president of Goizueta Investors, the business school's largest student club, he took over the Goizueta Real Estate Club as acting president when a void was needed to be filled. He is the co-founder and chief investment officer of the Goizueta Investment Management Group. As you heard, in this capacity, he helped secure unprecedented trust and confidence at the university level, as well as from donors, that allowed undergraduates to manage this fund, which I will say outperformed the S&P 500. He additionally conceived of and oversaw the creation of a financial literacy seminar in an inner city school, a project that was featured on Bloomberg TV. In recognition of the positive mark he is already making on and on behalf of our collective universe, it gives me limitless pleasure to present the Bert and Betty Shear Book Prize to Corey Edwards Moore. Beaufilet Jones Medal was presented at Emory College Class Day on Thursday, but for a variety of reasons that may or may not include shooting the hooch, we will once again recognize our recipient here today. The Goizueta Business School is delighted to recognize the graduating BBA student who best exemplifies the standards of devoted service set forth by Beaufilet Jones. At Goizueta, we believe that leaders emerge when strong competencies are activated by a desire to create positive organizational change and a willingness to take action. We recognize today's honoree for her citizenship both at Emory and in the larger community, her superior academic performance, and her already proven ability to be a change agent who positively impacts her profession and society as a whole. An extraordinary student, our recipient has an almost perfect GPA and has been inducted into a myriad of honor societies, starting with Phi Eta Sigma as a freshman and culminating this weekend, earlier today with her induction into Beta Gamma Sigma, and on Monday when she will graduate with highest distinction in the top 5% of her class. She has achieved this record while taking advantage of every educational opportunity she could squeeze into 4 years, from pursuing upper-level political science courses to completing area depths in both marketing and finance to traveling across the globe to spend a semester studying abroad in Hong Kong. Not surprisingly, she has been tapped to share her academic expertise with others, serving as lead presentation coach in business communications and as a teaching assistant in the BBA prerequisite course, Data and Decision Analytics. On the larger Emory campus, she is the ultimate student ambassador, serving not only as a tour guide but also as an admissions panelist, hometown host, and tour guide trainer. She has been a PACE academic peer advisor, a member of the Executive Roundtable of Leadership Emory, and she puts her considerable talent for promotions and marketing to use as the recording secretary and recruitment chair of her sorority and as public relations chair of the Inner Sorority Council. Her additional accolades include her designation as both a Goodrich White Scholar and the Goizueta BBA Bank of America Scholar, election to Mortarboard, induction into Omicron Delta Kappa National Leadership Honorary, and inclusion in the 2012 100 Senior Honorary. All of this would stand as sufficient reason to recognize her as an exemplar and role model, but what truly sets her apart is the fact that her campus scholarship and involvement is complemented by a significant record of service. She's a volunteer tutor in elementary schools, co-philanthropy chair of AD Pi Sorority, and most significantly, co-founder and treasurer of Send a Smile, an organization that sends more than 1,000 homemade cards a year to hospitalized children in Atlanta. It gives me enormous pleasure to present the Beaufilet Jones Medal to an ethically engaged, devoted scholar and leader of the BBA class of 2012, Allison Toba Daniels.
Thank you.
Todd Whitman Outstanding BBA Achievement Award is presented in memory of a former BBA student who managed to earn his degree while battling cancer. The award is given in recognition of many of the things for which Todd stood: a seriousness of purpose, a willingness to do whatever it takes to overcome obstacles, a desire to make a lasting contribution, and above all, a love of Emory. The Whitman Award is presented by the faculty and staff of the business school to the graduating BBA student who best exemplifies the qualities we seek in the undergraduate program. This somewhat amorphous definition takes shape in our recipient today in the form of superior academic performance, impressive work ethic, unwavering pursuit of individual and community aspirations, and outstanding strength of character. Our Whitman winner seeks neither glory nor the limelight, yet is always prepared to step up and step in. When he makes a commitment, which he does often, he is consummately reliable. He can be counted on to see the job through in its entirety and to get it done well. He applies the same diligence to the classroom. There's no such thing as halfway with him. Having completed area depths in both accounting and finance, he will graduate as a member of Beta Gamma Sigma with highest distinction in the top 5% of the class. The fact that he's about to realize his dream of becoming a Wall Street investment banker at a marquee firm is no accident. He has been planning this path since entering Emory and possibly since birth. To us, he stood out from the very beginning. Our admissions office remembers him as a freshman pre-BBA, completely committed to achieving whatever was necessary in order to join the program. Our Career Management Center vividly recalls the zeal with which he pursued an elusive bulge bracket sophomore internship. Later, after he had achieved a secure place on the iBanking path, he took the lessons he had learned about the need for resilience, networking, and perseverance and paid them forward, dedicating himself to helping other BBA students secure analyst opportunities. He formalized this role as guru of all things career-related this year, first as the BBA Council's chair of the Career Management Center, then as the student chair of the search committee for a new CMC executive director. Thank God that's over. And finally, as a career peer coach. Whether he was politely grilling a candidate about his or her ability to be a worthy advocate of our BBA students, enthusiastically prepping a BBA junior for a banking interview, or tenaciously arranging sufficient financial and computing resources for training the STREE program, he led with the high standards and professionalism that typify all his actions. His commitment to assuring that Goizueta students succeed in the job market is matched by an equal dedication to social responsibility. He's the green representative of his fraternity, promoting environmentally responsible practices around campus, and the rumor is that his peers asked that he not be allowed to pick the video on the ski trip bus because they were afraid it would be an inconvenient truth. Along with graduating BBA scholar Michael Seidman, he co-founded the Emory Chapter of Healing Spaces, which creates dream bedrooms for Atlanta children suffering from serious illnesses. For his academic accomplishments, tireless efforts on behalf of his fellow students, unwavering dedication to promoting the reach of the Goizueta Business School, and exemplary personal characteristics, it's my honor to present the 2012 Todd Whitman BBA Achievement Award to Adam Jeffrey Hamburg. Before we proceed to the last two awards, I'd like to acknowledge those students who will be graduating with honors. First, and listed in your program, we have four students who have earned the distinction of honors in the college while completing the BBA program. I'd like to ask them to stand. They are Dylan Michael Connor, with high honors in applied mathematics; Gregory Robert Boris, highest honors in economics; Hyun-Joo Lee, highest honors in music; and Richard Frank Walker, highest honors in philosophy.
Thank
Now hot off the press, BBA honors. Honors in the BBA program are determined based on class rank earned as a BBA student, a calculation that occurred late, very late, yesterday, when all final grades were received and recorded. Assuming this is something you might like to know, I'll announce the members of the class who will graduate with honors. I'll call the names in alphabetical order, starting with the group graduating with distinction in the top 20% of your class. Please rise when I call your name and remain standing, and let's try to clap once for the group at the end. Elizabeth Lauren Backash, Brian Raymond Bartlett, Brian Edward Blake, Vincent David Celentano II, Justina Cho, Ryan Aaron Daggerman, Alexander Epstein, Liam Timothy Greenemeyer, Adam Christopher Grenier, Alexander Scott Gutman, Ross Benjamin Hodison, Jared Lewis Horvitz, Alyssa Rachel Isaacman, Jonathan Matthew Lafer, Hyunju Lee, Katarina Rong Lee, Jeremy Ryan Lishman, Fun E. Liu, John Maros, Calvin Nguyen, Cyrus H. Parlin, Samuel D. Rothschild, Jacob Andrew Shapiro, Isha Sharma, Carly Jana Simkin, Stephen Charles Skinyetsny, Nicole Marie Taylor, Maria Treskinov, Shi Angie Wang, and Jamie Nicole Weinman. The following students are graduating with high distinction in the top 10% of the class. Please stand when I call your name and remain standing. Dorothy Kate Abrams, Stephen Michael Bomsey, Anne Marie Cheslin, Gabriella Christina Choi, Hawk Hei Fung, Lindsay Sarah Goldman, Seth Michael Green, William Dan Guo, Daniel Milton Kolb, Andrew Albert Krolitis, Janice Mingru Kuo, Brandon Michael Locke, Alexa Michelle Payton, Charles Gregory Punia, Michael Ian Seidman, Richard Frank Walker. Finally, graduating with highest distinction in the top 5% of the class, Joshua Robert Boer, Gregory Robert Boris, Aaron Samuel Brooks, Dylan Michael Connor, Allison Toba Daniels, Adam Jeffrey Hamburg, Callie Alyssa Jordan, Tristan Corey Kochik, Blake Num Kavanaugh, Imran Amin Manji, Michelle Suzanne Mullaney, Sari Faye Newman, John Michael Peterson, Benjamin David Schlang, Sebastian Sinisterra, and David Thomas Wichtman. Even among the gifted and talented, someone has to be at the very top of the class. The BBA Most Outstanding Academic Accomplishment Award is reserved for our most exemplary scholar, the person with the strongest academic record in the program. We do not print this award in our program, nor do we inscribe it on the award until after graduation, because it's determined at the very last moment, and I'm thinking that the person who won it doesn't know it yet. Today's recipient is the scholar of the utmost distinction, having completed 3 area depths in marketing analytics, analytic consulting, and information systems and operations management, along with a major in music from Emory College. You might know it now. He did so while serving as a resident advisor, a researcher teaching assistant for at least 4 different faculty members, as president of a BBA club, and as the principal saxophonist in the Emory Wind Ensemble and Emory Symphony Orchestra. In 4 semesters as a Goizueta Business School student, he completed 84 academic hours and earned only 1 grade below an A, a single A minus. Graduating with a 3.984 GPA, the Most Outstanding Academic Accomplishment Award goes to Blake Num Kavanaugh. our last award, the John Robson Outstanding Student Achievement Award, is named in honor of one of our most beloved former deans and recognizes the one student who best exemplifies the intent of the Goizueta Business School to achieve excellence across all facets of the institution. The winner is selected by the faculty and staff from among all graduating students in all programs of the business school. There are no clear criteria defining the specific characteristics of the recipient. Instead, it is expected that he or she will not have just pursued, but actually defined excellence among the student body in some fundamental way. Because all graduating students are eligible, it gives me particular joy to have the honor of presenting this award to a graduating BBA student. Of the many, many things that come to mind when I think about today's recipient, the most salient to me is a quote that Javier Goizueta invoked at the dedication of our building, citing it as one of his father's favorites. A leader is best when people barely know he exists. Not so good when people obey and acclaim him. Worst when they despise him. But of a good leader who talks little, when his work is done, his aim fulfilled, they will say, "We did it ourselves." More than anything else, today's recipient is about empowering and inspiring others. As president of your BBA Council, he held fast to one overarching mission: to lead the organization, its students, and the whole BBA program in the direction of its full potential. Although he has considerable strategic vision of his own, he remains much more concerned with helping his fellow elected officers and the student body at large to develop and execute initiatives of their own design. At his council meetings, everyone had a valued place at the table and every voice was heard. Ideas ranging from new programming like luncheons with faculty and the first Atlanta BBA alumni mixer, to the chartering of clubs like the Korean Leaders in Goizueta, to innovations like the 2012 Campus Movie Fest flash mob, to large undertakings like hosting Usher as the keynote speaker for the UBSLC, we were encouraged, supported, and flawlessly executed under his guidance. Because he was always so willing to personally pitch in and put forth his own efforts, he set an expectation for collaborative involvement that greatly facilitated the level of activity. Through the year, he has been a consistent and welcome presence in the BBA program office, stopping by to gently raise a potentially problematic issue, ask an opinion, or just reflect on the way things are going. He held his council accountable by setting the bar high, believing in them, and holding himself to a higher standard than he did anyone else. He's the kind of guy who organized a lunch for the BBA program staff to thank the team for its help. He never fails to compliment a council member for a job well done, and he always has a kind word for a fellow student, but yet he never expects or seeks any praise for himself. Leading well when everything is moving in a positive direction is relatively easy compared with leading under conditions of adversity. It is here that the most telling measure of today's recipient emerged. This year, as some of you heard, the BBA Council faced an unexpected, frightening, and seemingly insurmountable challenge to its divisional status that was supported by many constituents outside the school. He handled the situation with calming grace, extraordinary diplomacy, constructive alternatives, and creative alliances. He did so by taking charge, but never stepping into the limelight. As a result, the BBA Council emerged intact and arguably stronger than ever. And when it was over and his aim fulfilled, we all felt we did it ourselves. I can honestly say that of all the students I have encountered in the 25 wonderful years I've been part of this wonderful business school, he's the one from whom I have learned the most about leadership. It's with humility and respect that I present the 2012 John Robson Outstanding Student Achievement Award to Ali Baker Chuma.
For our second performance of the evening, we're having our International Ambassador Award recipient, Shreya Adiraju. She will be performing a song, a jazz song called Georgia on My Mind. Joining her will be Adam Bukas on the piano. Enjoy.
just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind. Ooh, yeah. Georgia, Georgia, a song for you comes as sweet and clear as moonlight through the pines. Oh, other arms reach out to me, other eyes smile.
Congratulations, everyone.
Thanks, Drea. Our classmate, John Lafer, will now be presenting the Distinguished Educator Award.
Good afternoon, friends, families, and students. Today, I've been given the great honor of presenting Goizueta Business School's Distinguished Educator Award for the 2011-2012 school year. Before I continue, I would like to acknowledge the efforts of our wonderful faculty members. You have all contributed to our success. Every year, one professor is hand-selected by the student body to be given the Distinguished Educator Award. The award is given to the professor who truly connects with his or her students while inspiring and motivating them to accomplish great things. I am fortunate this year to be able to present the award to a professor whose teaching style I have witnessed firsthand over the course of a semester. In his class, I learned how to succeed in both business and non-business endeavors. Students can attest to his ability to weave between theory and practice, all while impressively maintaining perfect eye contact with every member of the classroom. Some may know him as the professor who perfected the cold call, choosing one sleepy student at a time to barrage with questions, digging deeply for understanding. I entered the semester a naive junior, only to leave having felt like I had just gone 10 rounds with Tyson. Thank you for pushing us to be the best we can be. It is my honor to present this year's Distinguished Educator Award to Professor Chris Ryder. Unfortunately, Professor Ryder cannot attend today's ceremonies, but he sent me this email, yes, Grandma said email, to read to you all today. Thank you. I am greatly honored and very sorry that prior commitments prevented me from celebrating with you today. For two reasons, I am pleasantly surprised to receive this award. First, All of my colleagues are distinguished educators. This award makes me but one of many. Second, although probably half of 2012 BBA graduates completed my class, it is rumored that an equal, if not greater, number of students did not survive the first week. I am glad to have helped many of you prepare for future business success. Thank you again for this great honor. Congratulations on your graduation. And I hope that you all realize incredible returns on your investment in a Goizueta education. Thank you.
Up next, we have Callie Jordan performing a dancing to a contemporary piece called Vanishing.
Every year at Goizueta, a member of the student body is chosen to deliver a speech on behalf of the graduating seniors. This year's class oration will be delivered by Haley Ratner. Haley is a proud member of this class. She's also my sister in Kappa Alpha Theta. And she has contributed a lot, both within the Goizueta community and the campus at large.
We did it. 4 years of hard work behind us, and we are about to receive our diplomas. Congratulations to everyone, to the graduates on all your successes, to the parents on no longer having to pay tuition. As freshmen entering Emory, I'm sure not all of us knew that this is exactly where we would be on graduation day, considering Goizueta as a home away from home. Think back to that first day of orientation. We were nervous and excited about the new experiences to come. Luckily for us, the hypnotist broke the ice. Now look at what we have accomplished. We've all passed the pre-BBA requirements, matriculated into the business school, landed successful internships, and the assortment of companies that we will be working for next year looks like the Fortune 500 list. Just take a moment now and look around you. You will see the future of the business world sitting right here. As we graduate, we are all taking the next step in our lives. Some of us will be moving to new cities, others to familiar homes. One thing we must remember as we move forward is to not be afraid of failure. Roberto C. Goizueta, the namesake of the business school, is known for overseeing one of the biggest mistakes in business history. When Mr. Goizueta took over as CEO of Coca-Cola, nothing was safe from innovation in his mind. Goizueta pointedly told employees there would be no sacred cows in how the company did its business, including how it formulated its drinks. Goizueta explained, "New Coke or no Coke." New Coke was introduced in April of 1985, and a mere 79 days later, in July, the company returned to the original formula after receiving 40,000 letters in protest. It is estimated that Coca-Cola took a $30 million loss for this mistake alone. Coke had clearly misjudged America's love for an old friend. On the 10th anniversary of New Coke, Roberto C. Goizueta explained that it was the best thing that had ever happened to Coca-Cola, stating, "Today we are in the best shape as a company in many decades, and our stock price and our earnings are at an all-time high." We must remember this lesson. Despite this failure, Goizueta is considered by many to be the most successful CEO that Coca-Cola has ever seen. As we move into the workforce, we must reflect on Goizueta's mistake and the importance of taking risks and making decisions that may not be popular because no one ever got anywhere without taking risks. What failures and risks will we remember from our time at Goizueta? Some of us will focus on the risks we took or the moments where resilience was needed. Going to kegs and ending up in a dunk tank. The experience of showing up late to Professor Burdett's class and having to endure her making fun of you. Being cold called during Professor Ryder's class and not knowing the answer. What about that time you almost failed financial accounting? We will all remember rising from number seven to number three in Business Week rankings, and then dropping to number five, but still wearing the number three shirts around, clearly attempting to keep the dream alive. Or skipping your college class every Friday, because honestly, who has class on Fridays? Group projects that resulted in fighting over which font to use for your agenda bar, or accidentally hitting reply all instead of reply sender in an email. Spending hours staring at Excel spreadsheets, only to learn there's a simple shortcut available. What about that time you couldn't get a ticket to hear Usher speak? For all of us who went on the winter 2011 orientation trip, we will certainly remember the snow and cold we endured during our time in Rome, Georgia. I know I will remember the failed attempt by student government to restructure BBA Council, having to push boundaries and stand up for what I felt was best for the long-term success of the BBA program. Even though, as many of you are aware, that did not make me the most popular legislator on student government. Certainly, though, our time at Goizueta has also been filled with great rewards and successes. Many of us had the opportunity to study abroad, taking risks and jumping at the chance for new experiences that were not available here, making lifelong friends and learning to play nicely with others through group projects. The late nights in the library where jasmine sandwiches were suddenly the most delicious thing we had ever tasted. Working on a group project about Falafel King or Cliff Shuttles, with the final solution always turning out to be simply add another employee. Having a class schedule that allowed you to go to Wonderful Wednesday, learning the importance of networking and acting in a professional manner. The education we received here at Goizueta helped us gain amazing internships and full-time positions at top firms, acceptance into top law schools, and the opportunity to pursue our dreams, whatever they may be. When you look back at your time at Goizueta, what will you most remember? For some of us, We will remember deciding to take risks and dealing with small failures and learning to overcome the hard times. Others will remember the positive outcomes, acing Clifton Green's corporate finance exam, nailing an iBanking interview, spreading your bid points a bit too thin, but still managing to get the right sections of all your classes, finally figuring out what ISOM stands for, and somehow getting cleared for graduation with two area deps and a major in the college. I think we will all certainly remember the tight-knit community here at Goizueta, how even if you couldn't make a professor's office hours, they somehow always made time for you. We will all remember getting an exam out of our tub files, the ease of walking into the BBA program office and talking to someone about class advice or career advice. Most importantly, we will all remember the feeling of home when we enter the business school. While college students may claim we are exclusive, I say they're just jealous that they do not have the same feeling of community and support that we receive from our peers, as well as the faculty and staff at Goizueta. So what if we don't know where the math and science building is? We know where Jenkins Courtyard is, because that's where the keg is on Thursday afternoons. We know which breakout rooms are more likely to have cell phone service. We know how to get a semester's worth of PE credit for a weekend of skiing and fun. We know that if you want a coffee before class, you better be prepared to wait 10 minutes in line at Einstein's, and they only have mediums or larges, no smalls. We know that if a professor's office is on the fifth floor, we will be taking the elevator. We know that West 525 hosts some of the classiest events on campus. Most importantly, we know that we will always have a home here at Goizueta. Some of us may make $30 million blunders. Some of us may even be more successful than Roberto C. Goizueta himself. But I can guarantee that we will all feel at home here at Goizueta and know we are forever shaped by the risks we took and decisions we made as the BBA class of 2012. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, Haley. All right, next up we have BBA graduate Sam Rothschild, and he will be performing an untitled original composition.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Next, we have our senior superlatives. Thanks to all the seniors who took the survey and voted for themselves.
Presenting the superlatives this afternoon will be Jimmy Gia and Roy Massey.
All right, thank you guys so much for sticking around. We realize we are two of the last few people to keep you from the drinks and food outside, so thank you for this opportunity. And welcome to the last part of the afternoon where we will reveal the senior superlatives. I'm Roy.
I'm Jimmy.
And we want to thank you all for coming here today. We know that many of you have traveled from hundreds of miles away and are the closest friends and family of our Goizueta grads. And that being said, it is truly an honor for Jimmy and me to be able to embarrass our classmates in front of the people that care about them the most. They might be your beloved children, but to us they've been competition for making dean's list for the last four semesters. And so without further ado, let the superlatives begin.
All right, thanks, Roy. So going on to our first category, this Goizueta senior has been hard at work learning the principles of leadership from our experienced world-class faculty. He has taken all the relevant courses, such as Accounting 573, Advanced Salary Inflation, Marketing 420, Executive Cufflink Analysis, and of course, the famed Business 515, like a boss. Now, we have no doubt that this person will quickly rise to the top of any organization he enters. The three nominees are Imran Manji, Jared Horvitz, and Alex Epstein. And the student most likely to become CEO, as voted by our classmates, is Imran Manji. Congratulations.
All right, Imran. Nope, you can stay down there. See, he's ready to take the stand already. Stay down there, Imran. Don't worry about that. All right, next we move on to another impressive position. We find the student who is most likely to become the chairman of the Fed. This student has a passion and zeal to push our country in a bold direction towards financial solvency. He can't wait to put his finance and accounting skills under the scrutinizing eyes of the American public. In fact, the only difference between him and Ben Bernanke is the receding hairline. Just give it time. The three nominees for this coveted title are Michael Seidman, Adam Ginsberg, and David Chernow. And the 2012 grad most likely to be the chairman of the Fed is Mike Seidman. Congratulations.
All right, so we've all talked about kegs today, and so our next category is for the students who really feel that the most liberating feeling on a Thursday afternoon is walking out to the land of milk and honey, otherwise known as Dos Equis and Wingnuts. So the student that is most likely to attend kegs post-graduation are Amy Lin, Adam Grenier, and Rushir Patel. And the winner for this year, if you can't tell by the t-shirt, is Rushir Patel. Congratulations.
Believe me, it was a close race. It was a close race. Another close race is the next superlative we have. It was the Emory Goizueta student most likely to know every Excel shortcut possible. This is much coveted. This student has spent long hours learning all the powerful functions Bill Gates built into his spreadsheet program. He's learned how to analyze charts and graphs with complex formulas. And actually, the graph he's most familiar with shows a negative relationship between time spent in Excel and time spent talking to pretty girls. Not surprisingly, there are only two nominees for this title, Corey Moore and Alex Rodine. And the winner is Corey Moore.
Now here at Goizueta, you've certainly found out today that we learned a lot of things central to our education. One of the key points that we learned is how to blow through cash and be bold in making use of our earnings. Now, for example, if parents get a chance, please check out our new Brita filtration stations in the business school. I'm sure those things cost a pretty big penny. The seniors that are nominated to most likely first earn and blow $1 million are Alex Epstein, William Foster, and Charles Thayer. And the winner is William Foster.
I hope your Maserati can outrun the creditors, Will. Next, we find a student who spends a lot of time around other students and also a lot of time around herself. This student believes that their most productive hours are between 2 a.m. and 7 a.m. and is most likely to be in the library pulling an all-nighter. She views late-night study sessions as practice for a prestigious career in investment banking. Unfortunately, I don't think Goldman will pay you to stay up all night writing a two-page reflection on a Harvard Business Review case. The seniors being nominated for this superlative are Alexa Payton, Robin Davis, and Jen Bernstein. And the lucky winner is Alexa Payton. Please go get some sleep now, please.
All right, so moving on. It's always a risky game to challenge our beloved loose cannon law professor to a drinking battle. Of course, we're talking about the Diet Coke drinking feats of the legend, the one and only, the urban myth herself, Professor Allison Burdette. In fact, in a recent report issued by Standard & Poor's, it has been estimated that Professor Burdette single-handedly accounts for 15% of North America Coca-Cola sales. Few are bold enough to challenge her for the title of Diet Coke Queen. To give you a better idea of the infamous professor we're talking about, let's take a look at a classroom candid snapshot. Now, as you will notice, after drinking 16 Diet Cokes in a day, what happens is torts and contract law starts to be blurred with Michael Jackson's Thriller. Now, the daring nominees for this superlative are Caitlin Fowler and Cindy Lampert. And the winner is, which I'm not sure how healthy this is, Sydney Lampert. Congratulations.
Next, we come to the superlative that that you all definitely could probably predict. Most likely to participate even when not directly called on. This Goizueta senior has a strong desire to share her knowledge and to help other students, even when she isn't asked. Sometimes this desire to contribute urges her to volunteer answers for questions before the professor has a chance to ask them. I mean, but that's totally fine. You know, what do 20 years of work experience and a PhD teach you that you didn't already know when you were 22, right? The two nominees are Lee Horn and our beloved Haley Ratner. And the senior most likely to participate, even when not directly called on, is Lee Horn.
Do you enjoy waiting in long lines with stressed out freshmen? Are you the one that runs to Libby Egnor's office checking for advisory appointment slots? Do you crave and take those miniature candy bars at the receptionist desk? If that describes you, then you're like the three seniors nominated to be most likely to be found in the BBA office, who are Ollie Juma, Adam Hamburg, and Sal Phillips. The winner of this prestigious award is Ollie Juma.
All right, Ollie. And because we don't want to keep you for too long from getting the food and drink, we want to come to our final and arguably the most essential of the superlatives this evening. The superlative is reserved for one special senior, a senior who can spot Sequoia Capital on a business card from a mile away, a senior who would rather hire than be hired. He is not afraid of the struggles of business. In fact, he willingly chooses the challenge of deciding between the title of CEO, founder, founder slash CEO, or the simple boss for his LinkedIn profile. Compared to that struggle, applying to actual jobs would be easy. The senior nominated for this superlatives are William Hockey, Ryan Linkle, and Mark Miller. And the final winner of the evening is Mark Miller.
Well, class of 2012, congratulations to all the winners this evening and to all the graduates. You may not have a superlative that we'll remember you by, but we'll look to the sky whenever a jet flies overhead to see if your face is painted across the body. In all seriousness, we know that Goizueta class of 2012 will go on to be recognized for many great achievements. It is our hope that senior superlatives are but a small, humorous start to the countless prestigious titles that you are destined to earn. Class of 2012, it has truly been an honor. Keep it classy, keep it real, and remember, no matter where you are, what you do, or who you are, it's always kegs on Thursday, baby.
Well done. For our final performance of the celebration, we are excited to have Oral Pleasure once again. They'll be performing Have You Ever, an original composition by BBA alumni, Greg DeMatina and Trey Mullins, followed by our alma mater. You may join them if you wish.
We will ever see.
Thank you, Oral Pleasure. That was really great. Seniors, before you leave today, the BBA program office would like to send each of us off with a small graduation gift. There will be a gift table outside at the reception, so please stop by and pick up your gift. For those of you inducted into Beta Gamma Sigma, please also come by to pick up your certificate.
There will also be order forms available for you guys at the gift table for anybody wishing to purchase a DVD of today's celebration. The DVD will also include Monday's university-wide ceremony on the quad, as well as the BBA diploma ceremony in the Woodpeck.
Parents, siblings, families, thank you all for joining us this afternoon to celebrate the accomplishments of our senior class.
Fellow seniors, it has been a pleasure getting to know each and every one of you guys. Faculty, staff, and the program office, we truly appreciate all that you have done for us, and we will truly miss you next year. And for my mother in the audience, as well as every other mother here today, I want to wish you guys all happy Mother's Day.
So now, please go enjoy the food and drinks at the reception, and on your way out, please enjoy this video that several of our classmates created.
The preceding program is copyrighted by Emory University.